This meeting is called and convened this January 10th, 2017. Want to welcome you to our first meeting of the new year. Let us extend seasonal greetings and a happy new year to you. I hope 2017 is prosperous and healthy and all those things for you as we go into a new year. Having called the meeting to order, I'd ask that if you would, if you'll stand and join me for the Pledge of Allegiance, and then I'll lead an invocation for council following that.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Most kind and gracious Heavenly Father, we assemble here this evening as a council to seek your guidance to better serve this city. We thank you for the calling that you've placed upon our lives. We ask that you lead, guide, and direct us in all that is said and done this evening. We pray that you will always make us mindful of those that we serve and the calling that you have placed upon our lives to serve. I pray that we'll model our lives after the service of your Son, Jesus Christ. Lord, help us as we go through this cold weather here with the first of the year to remember those who are cold and hungry and to do whatever we can to meet their needs. We pray that you'll give us guidance and direction and insight to the items that you've laid out before us this evening. We ask all these things in your name. Amen. Well, again, I thank you for joining us this evening as we start a new year and look forward to that. Hats off to those folks who have already been pressed into action this year in terms of service for our city as our fire and police went on a snow alert and the rotations that they do in those types of events, and then certainly to our public services folks as they were making plans well ahead of storm and were out even the day before as they prepared, and I think did an excellent job of having us prepared. Got several calls from people in various different parts of the city thanking the city for the work that they did to make the roads as safe as they possibly could, and to help people that did need to get to work to do that and to make it as safe as they could. The only complaints I heard were from those that used the roads for sledding. They were a little disappointed that they got scraped so quickly and so thoroughly. That's the trade-off, I guess. So maybe we'll have to designate some hills that we'll leave unscraped at some point in the
That's
future.
A good idea.
We've come to our public forum. Part of our meeting this evening in public forum, we'll entertain those that wish to speak. Ms. Adams, did we have anybody that signed up for public forum this evening? All righty. Want to thank Ms. Adams for stepping in for Ms. Duncan this evening as she is away and maybe under the weather. So we want to thank Ms. Adams for filling in on short notice. With that, Council, you've got the minutes of the council meeting from December the 13th. I'll entertain a motion that they be received.
Second.
Have a motion and a second. Any items of note for the clerk? Hearing none. Ms. Adams?
Fairwood.
Yes.
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 Yes. Council, this evening you see there the departmental reports. We've discussed those in some regard over the past, and you'll find that activity listed there within those reports. We'll have more information from Ms. Cunningham in the Parks and Recreation Department in just a little while as she presents her annual report, and also the presentation this evening about our year-end audit. But as we prepare for those two reports, we want to welcome Mr. Seifert as he brings us our financial activity report. Mr. Seifert.
Thank you, Mayor and Council. Tonight, we're pleased to bring to you
the performance summary and results for the period ended November 30th of 2016. Starting with the general fund, we have revenue reported of $3,377,213 and expenditures reported of $7,198,639. Those expenditures are currently 10% under budget. Referencing the dashboards, we have a combined positive variance of $1,840,155. And then for the cash balance in the general fund, we have a carrying cash balance of $5,957,067. Moving to the hospitality fund, we have revenue reported of $850,657. That revenue number is 3% over budget. We have hospitality fund expenditures of $247,721 and a carrying cash balance of $1,600,855. And finally, in our stormwater fund, we have revenue reported of $13,629, stormwater expenditures of $104,341, and a carrying cash balance in the stormwater fund of $940,475. Again, this is just the performance summary for three of our major funds for the period ending November 30th. Be happy to take any questions you may have.
Thank you, sir. Council? Questions, comments? Appreciate the information.
Thank you.
We'll start our presentations this evening with the City of Greer year-end audit. Audit will be presented by our auditors, Lee Grisham of S. Preston Douglas and Associates, and in combination with Mr. Seifert.
Again, thank you, Mayor and Council. Tonight, this will be the last introduction I get for Lee for a while. This is his sixth and final year for doing the audit for the city, but this is Lee Grisham, one of the partners with S. Preston Douglas and Associates, and he'll be presenting the results for the audit for June 30th, 2016.
Let's get started. Again, I work for S. Preston Douglas and Associates, and we really appreciate the opportunity over the last 6 years to get to know David and Susan and the rest of the staff. Really made this enjoyable experience. So we have nothing but good news to present tonight. You should have the audit report, a copy of the audit report with you, as well as there's a sheet dated January 10th, 2017. And then there's some trend analysis right behind that. We'll go over all that information. First, let's go over the audit opinions on page 33 of the audit report. All right, in summary, we give the City of Greer for the fiscal year June 30th, 2016 a clean, unmodified audit opinion. A couple of notes on this page. Management is responsible for this financial information in front of you, and it's our responsibility to opine on what management has done. Further, it's also management's responsibility to design internal controls, so which we have a limited... Our opinion is kind of limited when it comes to internal controls. We're basically opining on the numbers that they're materially misstated or free from material misstatement. So again, that's the highest level assurance, clean audit opinion. And that's it. Any questions there? Okay, the next thing, I'd like to go to that page I referred to where it has January 10th, 2017. This is required communications that I need to make to council and management. Now I'm just going to hit the high points. Management, during the course of the audit, management provided full access to records. They were very organized, very forthright. They didn't withhold any information or you know, everything we requested, they provided in a timely manner. There were no new accounting policies adopted during the fiscal year. There were no uncorrected misstatements. We did not have disagreements with management during the course of the audit. We did not find any illegal acts, and we had no consultations with other auditors. So again, this is just a requirement that goes along with the audit that we're supposed to, you know, let council and management know at the conclusion of an audit. Any questions with that? Okay, the next page I'd like to look at is the compliance sections, page 173 through 175. Well, David wanted you guys to look at this because there was a finding last year. I don't know if many of you remember, but there was a over budget on one of the line items in the general fund related to, I think it was public safety. And if you go to page 175, this shows that there were no findings. I mean, it says internal control, material weakness, there was none. There was no significant deficiencies, there's none there, and no non-compliance to the financial statements. But last year we did have something there, and that has been corrected for this fiscal year. Okay, and let's go through a couple of pages in the audit report that I think are important. If you get back home and you need something to read at night to fall asleep, you can go to page 37. This is the MD&A. This is a good overview of everything that's in the rest of the financial statements. We just talked about, and a lot of it's comparative, so you'll have a little bit of at least a year by year of the balances from 2016 and 2015. But that starts at page 37. And again, I wouldn't read that right now, but you can read that later. So let's go to page 52. This is the statement of net position. Now, this is the consolidated city's balance sheet. So it takes all the funds and it rolls it up here and includes fixed assets, includes debt. And I'll just read off a couple of numbers. Total assets for the city of Greer at June 30th, 2016, it was just under $20 million at $19,697,515. Oh, excuse me, that was total current assets. Total assets for June 30th, 2016, $54 million, $544,389. So just over $54 million total assets. On the next page, current total liabilities, $5.4 million. And then you got total liabilities, $35 million. And then all the way down the page, your net position, which is basically your assets minus your liabilities for the city of Greer, June 30th, 2016, $21 million. Okay, let's flip to the next page, 54 and 55. Now, this is a statement of activities, which is basically the income statement of the consolidated city of Greer. So all the funds come together, business type and proprietary funds. I'm just going to give you the change in net position. Change in net position, which is basically your net income for the governmental funds, was $2.4 million. And then for the business type, which is the stormwater fund, there was an increase in net position of $232,000 for a total increase of the government-wide statements of $2.6 million. Any questions? Okay, on to the next page, 56 and 57. Now, these are the governmental funds, and you can see them. It starts with the general fund, and it's broken out by column. So the next several pages will be a breakdown of the balance sheet for the governmental funds. I'll just read total assets, which you'll see on page 57. If you total all the assets of the governmental funds, it's $17 million. Approximately $17 million. And you flip to the next page, page 58 and 59. And on page 59, you'll see the total liabilities of the governmental funds to be $1.5 million. And then scrolling on down, total fund balance for the governmental funds, which again, that's the assets minus liabilities, it's your equity, is for the total governmental funds is $15.8 million.
So is that where you get your ratio? Not assets, but income over expenses. Is that right? Is that
Are you talking about the expenditures, the fund balance as it relates to expenditures?
Yes.
Yeah, that one actually I have that figure as well. That's you take the unassigned, so if you look at, page 58, you know, and you have the column, the general fund column.
Right.
You take that unassigned portion, that $9.9 million, and you divide that into, you'd have to flip over. Flip over to page 64 under the general fund. You'll see the total expenditures. It's $18.9 million. Do you see that?
Yes.
So you take that $9 million and divide it by 18, you get about 54%. So that's the coverage. That kind of represents the emergency fund. I guess 6 months of expenses is what that number represents. I think that's what you were asking.
Yes.
Okay.
I'm assuming, is that good?
That is very good. Everything in this, I didn't state this here. Everything in this presentation is good. It's going to be good.
If I may, one of the ratios that we focus on is our fund balance ratio. And the ratio, it's our fund balance target that's in our financial policy, is 35%. And that, we compute that as the fund balance as compared to the following year's approved budget. Okay. And that number, our target is 35%. And with this particular audit, we're having a 44% coverage. So we're 9% over the target, which is again a very good, very strong position. This one to be allowing us to hopefully bring forward some a plan for projects here in the future.
Okay, let's continue on. Page 62, this is the governmental funds. Revenue, total revenue, so 62 and 63. And there again, you can follow the columns of each of the funds listed here. The total revenues for the year ended June 30th, 2016 was $25.9 million. And if you flip to the next page, you'll see the total expenditures for the governmental fund to be $25.4 million. And then flipping to the next page, the total net increase in fund balance for the governmental funds was $1.8 million. So again, that 1.8, you can see it on page 67, that represents the net income, so to speak, of the governmental funds. Okay, page 69, this is where the general fund budget to actual page is, and This is last year, we had mentioned that there was a finding. Last year, the finding was on page, I think, 71, where there was a, I think it was the police department had gone over, you know, so you see that there's the original budget, the final budget, and then the actual, so you're comparing the actual to the final budget numbers. And this year, they had, you know, the city had corrected, and there was no budget overages in any of the funds or any of the departments. You could see that on the, you know, the next several pages. All right, page 74 and 70. Let's just start at 74. This is the stormwater fund. And here you can see the total assets of the stormwater fund, $2.1 million. Total liabilities, $928,000. And then the total net position, $1.2 million. And then again on page 76, again, the stormwater fund. This is basically the income statement for the stormwater fund. Total revenues, $734,000. Total operating expenses, $113,000. So then you have the operating income is $620,000. And then the total net change, the total net position change was $232,000. So. Okay, one other thing about the report. Again, if you want to look at this at home, if you have access to it, page 150 starts, there's the statistical section. So each of these has 10 fiscal years of information. So if you just want to see where the city of Greer has gone, by these various statistics, you can see there's probably 15 pages that Susan prepares every year. You can blame her on the formatting. It's not right, but okay, last thing. Let's look at the graphs that you have in front of you. Should be 5 pages. I'll admit I made a huge mistake on these graphs. I should have used the tiger orange color. But no, David, I have to apologize. I printed these out last night. I thought they were going to lose too, so we have to stick with the blue. That's my favorite color.
Oh no,
it's good.
But okay, this first page, general fund balance. This is actually unassigned general fund balance. And all of these trends are actually very, very positive. So you'll start with the left column, or the, you know, it starts with 2012 on the left, 13, 14, 15, 16. The unassigned general fund balance at the 2016 column is $9.9 million. It's the highest it's been in 5 years. But you can see all the way in 2012, it was 3.7. So you can kind of see where the city of Greer has come in the last 5 years. All right, the next page, general fund revenues over expenditures. And again, this is kind of the operating income of the general fund. You can see it's the highest it's been in the last 5 years. So in 2016, it was $2.2 million. The year before, it was 2.1. And if you go all the way back to 2012, the general fund revenue over expenditures was only about $1 million. So just to give you a little bit of perspective in the last 5 years. All right. Next page, similar trend with stormwater fund net assets. 2016, $1.26 million in fund net assets for the stormwater fund. The year before, it was just over $1 million, and then the previous years, it was under $1 million and wavered between $900,000 to $700,000 in 2012.
So. And then the next one, debt outstanding. Another positive trend, this time going down. 2016, the debt was 18 total long-term debt, $18.2 million. 2015, it was 19.7. And then the year before, 2014, it was 21.4. So you're seeing the debt gradually being paid down over the last 5 years. Next page, cash. This is the last one. And again, another positive, at least in my opinion, positive trend. Cash balance in 2016, $18.5 million. 2015, $16 million. 2014, $14 million. 2013, 10, and then all the way back in 2012, there was only $8 million at 6/30. So June 30th, 2012, there was only $8 million. So you see the significant increase in the cash balance over the last 5 years for the city of Greer. So really nothing negative this time. There's no findings, unmodified report, and the city seems to be on good track, in my opinion. Any questions?
Council?
Say again what stormwater fund. I know that it's, you've got net assets. What are our, what page, where can I look at the information as far as revenue and actual cash on hand versus expenses
for that particular fund?
Yes.
That would be 76. Let's see. Yeah.
74 through 79.
Right. But just the revenues and expenses were on 76. If you're looking, wanting to look at that.
Other questions, council? Comments? Anything else to add?
Just real briefly, if I may. In particular, we have, you know, a few funds that we like to focus on, one of those being the hospitality. And we use that as a gauge to, you know, judge our local economy and the health of just the local economy. So I'd like to point out on page 63, this is where you'll find, as Lee described, this all of what we call our major funds, the governmental funds, broken down by column. The far left-hand column is where you'll find all the detail on the general fund. But the first column on the right-hand side of the page, which is page 63, is the local hospitality and accommodations fund. You'll see revenues there of $1.9 million. And in the comparative information to the prior year is not presented here, so I'm just to explain it to you verbally, the revenues last year were $1.8 million. So between 2015 and 2016, it's about that, you know, little over $100,000, about $140,000 growth just in that 1 year. So, you know, using that as a you know, a gauge, the local economy here is holding steady, very strong, increasing, and we've seen those same results in the announcement from the Greer Development Corporation on our total retail sales, where we just set the record again for Greer this past year. So, you know, those trends are holding true using this fund as a gauge. And then just pointing out a few things on pages 66 and 67. Again, we're in the major funds, beginning with the general fund on the far left-hand column, page 66. The increase to fund balance in the current year, $1.5 million. the first column on page 67, increase to fund balance of hospitality, $334,000. Two columns, the next two columns over, federal confiscations fund is a fund that there's special interest there. There's still a remaining fund balance of $835,000. And as you're aware, that's funds that the police department holds through the confiscations. So there's $835 there remaining that is planned to be spent and is budgeted, but has remained to be fully expended.
Is there a timeline on that, those funds to be expended?
There is a general guideline, and they like those funds to be spent within 3 years, but they are flexible in that, knowing that, especially with the amount of money that we received through that, that it was going to be hard to spend that level of money within that time limit. So they have not held us to a three-year limit to spend those funds.
And we did receive those funds over an extended period of time as well, so it was constantly being extended.
And then just the last couple of things I want to point out, and I'm not going to read through them, but starting on page 107 is where you get into the detail of our long-term debt. It covers our general obligation bonds, our lease purchase agreements, the installment purchase revenue bonds, which is the debt held by Greer Trust, the revenue bond. And then on page 110 is a summary of all of those different sources of long-term debt. If you'll, you know, review that, those pages will detail the minimum debt service requirements over the next 5 years and beyond till that debt is fully paid back. And then, but really on page 110 is the summary for all the debt, and it gives you a good snapshot of all our debt across the whole city and when the balances and the increases and decreases in the current year.
Is the trust bond, is that Greer Trust?
Correct.
Okay.
The Greer Trust bonds are detailed on page 109. And you can see there that the debt service payments take us out to 2026. Again, that's page 109.
So now we're on that. No, wait a minute. That's wrong. We are in that period, aren't we? We're close to that period where that debt service on that money
is at least level and starting to decline a little.
Okay.
So you see there on the far right hand side on page 109, the debt requirement for 2017 is 1.6 million.
Right.
The next year 1.6, and then the subsequent years it starts declining a little bit to under 1.6. And then the last number there is an aggregate number for the next 5 years. So the debt service requirement for those last 5 years will remain steady, but will steadily decline also by little increments, decrements rather.
We have less than 10 years to pay it off.
The
is 2026 trust? The end of that payment?
Correct.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Anything else?
Others? We appreciate it. Thank you, Lee.
Thank you.
We appreciate your time as well, too. David, if you would, I know you've got at least Susan. I don't know if we've got others from the department, but if you'll recognize those folks quickly while they're here.
So we do have with us this our accounting manager, Ms. Susan Howell. She may not want to stand up, but she is here with us.
Apparently not.
But she, you know, but she has been a great help in preparing these statements, and you know, we could not do without her, and with not just only her, but the whole staff. I mean, everybody puts in a lot of hours putting this together and pulling the information, and, you know, to prepare these statements and for the daily activity that we do. it's a great team effort that we have.
We never want to take it for granted, but we have been notified that we've been awarded another CAFR award, and that is
not yet. That was that email that I sent out was providing the statement.
Statement for the CAFR award.
We'll find out on this one probably in July.
Okay.
But we expect to, yes.
We have every expectation that we'll be receiving a CAFR award sometime this summer for the work that they have done. And I jokingly told David we're going to have to move around the corner of the hallway because we've just about filled one hallway with those awards. But hats off to our financial department and administration for the work that they do in that regard and the affirmation that we get from our accounting and audit procedures as well, too. Thank you for your work on that. As we have positioned ourselves here to very wisely make the best use of our citizens' money. So thank you, Beard.
Thank you
very much. Well, the scariest thing that Mr. Grissom did all evening was ask if he could close the computer because I saw the entire rec department sit forward with, lean forward with eyes and mouths aghast. I thought, there goes my entire presentation down the drain. So you've been saved. So.
I started to panic. I
thought the whole row was coming up to attack him or something. Ms. Ann Cunningham is our Director of Parks and Recreation, and this evening she'll be presenting her annual report. So welcome.
Thank you. Good evening, Mayor and Council. A handout has been provided to each of you that contains the detailed 2016 annual report for the Parks and Recreation Department. And this document contains action improvement items updated through the four components of the City of Greer Strategic Plan, participant numbers, events, and highlights from each division that make up the Parks and Recreation Department, as well as 2017 highlighted projects. I'd like to take this opportunity to share with you through a PowerPoint presentation some of the highlights from 2016 and those proposed in 2017. This is the construction project at Century Park, and this project that was funded by Land and Water Conservation Fund grant and general fund dollars. We are in the final stages of construction with Malul Blamey, who is our contractor. The project went pretty smoothly, and we are in good standing relative to budget. This slide shows the conceptual overview of the construction project at Century Park. It includes pictures of the new concession press box building, picnic shelter, restroom maintenance facility, and plaza area. The new field lighting components were installed and they were ready for our fall leagues. The following slides show the conceptual drawings next to the finished product. Here you can see that's our maintenance area that's in the back of the picnic shelter. This is our press box and concession stand. This is a front view of our picnic shelter with the restrooms and then our maintenance areas on the very back of that. And then again, our press box and our concession. New amenities will include park signage, bleachers, shade structures, a public address system, a dugout covers, picnic tables, and trash cans. And we are planning a celebration on April 1st, which is our opening day, where we will present all of the parks and features to our patrons. And we will certainly be sending out information and hope that y'all will be able to join us. This slide shows the before and after pictures of the Center for the Arts facility, formerly known as City Auditorium. Phase one is complete. We're under budget, and we currently have 6 artists in residence. We have 2 photographers, 2 painters, and 2 jewelry makers. The Greer Cultural Arts Council is using this facility for play rehearsals and for their board meetings. We opened the facility to the public on Thursday, November the 3rd. Jim Quick and Coastline performed, and residents were able to meet our artists and view their artwork in their studios and in the art gallery. We also gave tours of the facility and were really well received by the community. With money saved from phase one, we are able to move forward with purchasing office furniture for our cultural arts staff, and blinds for all 41 windows in that building. And this was originally scheduled for phase two, so we're glad we can go ahead and move forward with that. And we hope to begin planning and designing for phase two in the near future. This is Turner Field in 2015, and you can see the standing water that resulted from a drainage problem that we had. The perimeter fencing had just been removed before we took this picture. Wooden poles with outdated light fixtures and bleachers that needed to be replaced are shown. Here you can see an overhead shot of our conceptual plan based on the needs of our programs, which included an open, multi-use space with backstops and a defined parking area. And this is how the fields look today. This renovation has provided a much-needed public open space that's available for various uses. We've observed everything from sports to families flying kites and throwing frisbees, to friends flying drones and racing remote-controlled cars at this site. It's a great project. An assessment was performed by Leathers and Associates at Kids Planet. They are the original architectural firm that designed the playground and oversaw the construction of Kids Planet 1 in 1999. Options they provided in the assessment were to retrofit existing structures or to replace with new units. We've received an estimate to conduct a survey of the site as part of a proposed master plan process to renovate this playground, and we are exploring funding options for moving forward. This slide represents South Super Road Park. The original section is in the middle, and highlighted are the two additional parcels of land, which total approximately 8 acres, which was acquired after development of the park. $10,000 was allocated through hospitality funds to conduct a master plan of this site, master plan study of the site. Alta Planning and Design was selected as consultants for the development of this plan. A project steering committee was created in the spring of 2016 and was comprised of city staff, volunteers, and our local business leaders. We met 3 times throughout the year, and a final plan is being drafted based on the needs of our patrons and projected community growth in that area, and it will be presented to you in the spring of this year. And in partnership with CPW, we changed the heads on our light fixtures at Veterans Park. They were 175 watt metal halides, and we went to 40 watt LEDs. And this continues our efforts to go green and to save energy. We were able to reduce the cost of upgrading our exterior lights by repainting the existing poles and only changing the heads. Some of our highlighted programs for this year include the Needmore After School Garden Club. It was established after a partnership with Greer's Primrose Garden Club. A plant day was held in August to plant fall plants, and from there, representatives from the Primrose Garden Club met and continue to meet with our Needmore Garden Club students once a month and teach a lesson about the garden and plants. This intergenerational program teaches proper watering, growing, weeding, and harvesting, which are all fundamentals that students are learning. Our students are incorporating their harvest into their healthy after-school snacks and their meals. And we've had great success with this program. The events division hosted the first annual Rail Fest at City Park on September the 10th, and over 1,000 guests learned about the importance of trains in the upstate and were instructed on how to remain safe around railroad tracks. Participants enjoyed a fun day learning about rail safety and the history of Greer. The Center for the Arts currently has 6 working artists. We've hosted 2 events at this location: the Art Celebration, which again was held in November, and our first Open Studios was held on December the 8th. And we've received many requests over the years from our parents to provide youth basketball. After consulting with our Malden Recreation Department about the possibility of interleaguing, we advertised for registration, and we currently have 3 teams that we've formed in each age group. We have an 8U, 10U, and a 12U team. This year, we were the recipients of $18,000 in grants from organizations such as the Greenville County Redevelopment Authority, BMW, the Inland Port, and the Metropolitan Arts Council. $34,000 was acquired in monetary sponsorships, and approximately $22,000 was received from in-kind donations. Our staff works hard each year to find ways to enhance their programming through obtaining grants, sponsorships, and donations. And in 2017, some of our highlighted projects that we would like to propose. The Center for the Arts Phase 2 consists of interior building renovation to accommodate additional programming. It will also include exterior building, park, and parking lot renovations. We hope to begin the planning and design for Phase 2 in the near future, and we're currently working with the artists to plan a year-long series of open studios to highlight the artists and bring the public into the facility. We will be installing a subterranean tile drainage system on South Super Road Park Field 1. It's the far right field. And this drainage system, which proved successful at Greer City Stadium, will catch both rising water from the water table and surface water and carry lateral drains leading away from the field so we can use that area. In preparation for development of Kids Plan Master Plan, we've received an estimate, as I'd said before, to conduct a survey of the site so we can begin the process to renovate this playground. And again, we're exploring funding options for moving forward. In the winter of 2015, we removed the bridge in Century Park, originally built in 1976. Money budgeted in this year's hospitality funds are being used to pay for professional services such as engineering, architectural design, topographical survey, and sole borings. We have applied for PARD funds to construct and install the bridge this spring. And the South Super Road Park Master Plan is being drafted based on the needs of our patrons and projected community growth in that area. Again, it will be presented to you in the spring of 2017. When the Cannon Center was renovated in 2012, the restrooms were not included in the scope of work. And this renovation project includes new tile on the floors and the walls of the men's and women's restrooms, plumbing to be removed and reinstalled after renovations, and new ADA-approved sink vanities. With increased programming at Turner Field, batting cages will be installed to accommodate additional teams. And the addition of public art includes installation of 8 smaller tube dudes throughout the greater downtown area. Tube Dude is geographically restricted to ensure uniqueness to Greer. If well received, an additional 8 statues will be purchased to be placed throughout the city. I'm very proud of the work and dedication of our staff members, the job that they do every day. They're here with us tonight. I would ask that you stand, if you would. And these are our supervisors and managers. I'm very appreciative for the support and advocacy of our Recreation Association Board of Trustees and our ad hoc committee representatives. We were originally going to have a meeting after this one tonight. We postponed that meeting, so I'm not quite sure who's here. Not quite sure anybody came today or was able to come. But I really do appreciate all their support. They're appointed by you, and they do a tremendous job. And I'm also grateful for the continued support and partnership with the Greer Cultural Arts Council. And I believe some of our Arts Council, y'all are present. If y'all could just stand, that would be great. Really do so much for our partnership. Thank you. That's great. Thank you for the opportunity to present. I will be glad to answer any questions you might have about our presentation or about our handout. It's a lot of information. I knew I couldn't share it all, but I just tried to get the highlights. So I'd be glad to answer any questions.
The South Super Park that you talk about, is that across from Riverside High, or is that down down at where they play soccer all the time?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, okay.
Yes,
ma'am. You're doing your plan for the the arts facility. If you would try to see if we could, for the landscape, hardscape, because it's a pretty sizable lot, if we could incorporate some LED lighting without overhead lines, some landscaping that, if we're going to put any grass, let's make sure it, you know, is watered, that kind of stuff.
That would be great.
Yeah.
And especially if we ever plan or propose to use land and water conservation funds, we can't have overhead utility lines, so that would at least put us ahead of that for future.
And I'm still amazed at the disc golf course. The other day, with 5-6 inches of snow on the ground, there were people out there playing.
They're always there.
Yeah.
So it's really a great venue.
They've got a serious following.
They do.
Yes, they do.
Others? As usual, we want to thank y'all for all that you're doing, for the diversity of programming and for the services that you provide. We saw your folks out as well this weekend and early this week, helping with public services and working in our parks to make sure that they were as safe as we could, as many visitors as we had in the parks during the snow. So thank you for all that you're doing.
Thank you. And I did want to say I would feel remiss if I didn't mention this because it is my alma mater, but we're really, really happy that our national champion. Thank you. Thank you.
And could we get a quick word from Robin possibly about events coming up this spring? I know we've got the International Festival, which will be in Ashland as well. Just kind of a brief overview of what we may want to keep in mind here as we move forward this spring.
Yeah, absolutely. Our International Festival is coming up quickly. So that is taking place April 22nd. So we would love to have you out there. We have well over 50 countries represented throughout that day between entertainment, food, country booths, just everywhere throughout this park. So we would love to see you there on April 22nd from 10 to 3 or 11 to 4. All right.
The Foothills Philharmonic will be performing at the Cannon Center the first Saturday in February, and then we have the Juried Art Show reception coming up on March 23rd. I'll be pulling some of you into work to help me judge the art show again. Thank you. We have the Greer Children's Theater has Madagascar coming up the last weekend in February, first weekend in March. And I'm going to be meeting with the artists at the Art Center really soon. We'd like to put together a year-long event similar to what they do in downtown Greenville with like the third Thursdays or first Tuesdays, because in Greenville they do the first Fridays, and we don't want to compete with that. And I'll be working with, hopefully with Kyle Mensing, to coordinate something downtown so it benefits all of us. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Watson, can you tell us how glad you are about the Tigers winning?
Oh, you're over there.
Happy to be here.
That was ouch.
I will speak for Red and give him kudos because he actually made that slide for me today. And oh.
I've said it all day. That was incredible. I'm a big Gamecock fan, but that was something special that happened for Clemson last night. So real happy for all the Tiger fans out there. Well, thank you for all your hard work and for being here tonight.
Speaking of Clemson fans and Gamecock fans, we'll turn it over to our resident Gamecock fan, our administrator. So, Mr. Drigger, the city.
I was well prepared for Tiger Rag endlessly from the bell tower today. It's wonderful to work in an environment that we can be passionate about our teams and support each other. Speaking of which, again, kudos to our great team at our Parks and Recreation Department. As you are well aware, they work very, very hard for the residents of our community and the visitors of our community. We are responsible for entertaining and providing recreational facilities and programs, not only for our community, but for those folks who visit our community as well. And tonight's intent was to give you some highlight of what they are involved in. If we can provide any additional information to you, we're glad to do that. We want to make sure that you are informed and that you can share with your constituents the programming and the activities that we have available to our community. So, Ann, to you and your full team, we thank you for the efforts and the work that you're doing each and every day. Things have gone extremely well for us, so as we are looking and approaching the new year, 2017, I think it's also appropriate that we do look back at the presentation that was made concerning our audit. We cannot overemphasize the significance of the financial strength of our city. We have come a long, long way, and we appreciate the leadership and the guidance that our mayor and council have provided to us as we've continued to develop strategies and to look at implementing policies that would allow us to undertake some of the projects that we've been talking about for the last couple of years. Positioning ourselves to be able to do that and to be able to do that with limited use of debt well positions us to be able to move forward with some of those projects, and we'll be able to continue to share some additional information with you on that. But to David and your staff as well, congratulations on presenting that information in a way that our auditors are supportive of us. Transparency, which someone said earlier today as we were talking about some of the activities of our city, it is our intent through our comprehensive annual financial report, our audit, and our monthly financial statements, we want our community to be constantly, repeatedly informed about what we are doing with the resources that are made available to us. So we encourage, if you have any questions concerning any part of that audit, we want to make sure that we are available to answer those questions. It is a complex and it is a lengthy document, so we do encourage you to spend some time working through it. And as those questions come up, we ask that you dog ear it or mark it or put a post-it note on it, and we are always available to be able to answer any questions concerning that audit. We do post that online as well, so we encourage our community to take a look at that. We encourage the members of our media to please make sure that our public is informed that that document is available for them for their review as well, and we encourage and we offer the opportunity to answer questions to our general public as well. So glad to be able to do that. As we do approach 2017, we do have some very exciting things that are happening. A couple of those are calendar items. Certainly want to make sure that we are aware of. Again, in reference to our recreation department, they are the backbone behind at least the staffing of, and of course Mr. Griffin is the backbone behind making sure that we are on task with our annual Martin Luther King weekend celebration. This year marks our 15th annual celebration. It is a milestone for us as a community. That will be taking place next Monday on Martin Luther King Day, January 16th from 11:30 to 2 here at City Hall. If you plan to attend, I hope you have your tickets, or otherwise we will tell you about next year's date. It is a sold-out crowd, as it is every year. And so this facility turns into a grand celebration for that event, and we thank Mr. Griffin for his efforts and our staff members, Justin particularly, working on that event. Mr. Griffin, I ask if there's anything that you would like to add in reference to our support and recognition for that program next week.
First, I want to give a great big thanks to Justin, because the last couple of years he's carried me. I mean, he really has, because I couldn't have done it without him. He's put in a lot of work behind the scenes, and I just want to say thank you, Justin. And like to invite those of you that haven't been a part of it to come out and see it. It's really great. It's quite an event. I mean, it's hard to put it into words, but if you come, I'm sure you'll feel it, you know. We have a pretty good time there. And I'd like to thank the city for its support over the years. It's hard to believe it's been 15 years.
15 years, absolutely.
Yeah, maybe soon.
It continues to be a wonderful celebration for us as a community. As was mentioned earlier, there are a number of things that are taking place. We will send these to you electronically as well. But one of the new events for us as a community is we're doing the food truck rollout. We're looking at doing that quarterly this year, and our next one is scheduled in January, so it may be a little cool. So I imagine one of those, we may be substituting the yogurt and ice cream truck maybe for the hot chocolate truck on that event, but our folks are getting prepared for that, and that'll be taking place here at City Park on January the 20th, and again, we'll have some information to you coming out on that. We are participating with a number of communities around Spartanburg County in a project called Healthy Community 50. The municipalities of the city of Spartanburg, Greer, Inman, Landrum, Packlet, and also Woodruff, and our partners at Spartanburg County, offers an opportunity on Saturday, January the 21st, gathering about 9:30 that morning for us here at City Park, to join our elected officials in a walk. That walk will be taking place at 10 o'clock on that morning. I believe it's a mile and a half walk that we will be kicking off countywide in Spartanburg County, recognizing that as elected officials and as public officials in our respective communities, that you indeed have great influence in encouraging members of our public to get out and get moving. And we think that this is a wonderful way that we'll be working with the Mary Black Foundation and other folks that have provided some grant funding for that program on that date. So again, Saturday, January 21st is the Healthy Community 50 project, and we will be participating with that here in Greer as well. Several of you are signed up to participate with the Municipal Elected Officials Institute. You are now all at the graduate level in that program, and several of you are participating at that program. You'll be in Columbia on Tuesday, January 31st, and then also several of us will be joining you there for the next day on February the 1st. We will be in Columbia with the Municipal Association recognizing Hometown Legislative Action Day. That is an opportunity for us to meet with our elected officials there in Columbia, either on the floor of the House or Senate or in their respective offices. It is always a good opportunity for us to be able to share our legislative agenda and those things that are important to us back at home that are near and dear to local government. We're able to share that with our state representatives. So I do hope that you are planning to attend that event. I know several of you have been working with Tanny to get reservations and those types of things taken care of. Another date that I need to ask you to go ahead and place on your calendar, important for us as a community, is our Greater Greer Chamber of Commerce annual meeting. That will be taking place on Thursday evening, February 16th. Again, I will send some information to you asking you of your attendance plans for that event, but we are a table sponsor as part of our support of our local chamber, and we will be participating there with them for their annual meeting. Again, that is on Thursday evening, February the 16th. And as we are preparing now for our annual planning retreat for Mayor and Council, we've been in communication with Mayor Danner, and we would like to offer to you that we would consider March 7th and 8th. That is a Tuesday and Wednesday. Again, March 7th and 8th. That is an off Tuesday than when you would normally meet. That would be the first Tuesday of March. And so we are looking at a schedule that would accommodate your schedules, and so we will have some additional conversation with you about what time that event would start and stop on each of those days. But we are asking if you would consider allowing us to do your planning retreat on March 7th and 8th as we plan our agenda and our all of our objectives, updating our strategic plan, moving into 2017 formally, and then allowing us to use that information to prepare our budgets as we would approach that later on, a few months after that, and then allow us, as our staff meets, to make sure that we are incorporating those plans that you have outlined into our work plan citywide. So again, we offer March 7th and 8th for your consideration, and we'll have some additional communication about how that schedule would work best for you. I do want to share with you a little bit about our response to the snow event that was mentioned a little bit earlier. Preliminarily, we have a few numbers for you in our public services department. We had 12 employees that worked 435 hours over the weekend responding to our storm event. They traveled 1,215 miles plowing and sanding and salting city streets. We used about 15 tons of sand and 26 yards of salt in that effort. As was mentioned as well, our police and fire were on staff fully. We made sure that those departments were ready. We had no unusual call volume, no incidents that we need to report to you. Things were well staffed and were well handled during that weekend event. And then we also had, through our recreation department, a number of folks that were involved providing an additional 62 hours of resources for us, allowing us to make sure that sidewalks and steps were cleared here for events that were scheduled at the Cannon Center, here at the Event Center at City Hall, and then also preparing us for patrons to use our police department and our courthouse and also City Park immediately following that event. So as was said earlier, it is indeed a team effort. Most all of Team Greer is involved when we have a storm event, and we are grateful to their efforts. This was a weekend event for us, so we had to pull in a lot of our people to make sure that we were covered adequately through that event. We are continuing to move forward in our communications with Greenville County concerning our radio systems. We've been talking with you for a number of years now. You may recall that there is an effort through the County Sheriff's Department, through the Countywide Fire Chiefs Association, through all the special purpose districts, 911, EMS, and all of the municipalities within Greenville County, as we are looking for a communication system, a radio system that would serve all of us. There are a number of components, as you can imagine, with that many agencies that are using that type of a system. We are anticipating that there will need to be upgrades to equipment. We also are anticipating that there will be recurring costs that will be there reflected to licensing agreements and those types of things. But after about a three-year period of working through, studying this effort, they through the communications department with Greenville County, they are prepared to offer some additional information to us. We will be participating at that event on January the 19th. Elected officials are invited to attend that, but we're going to be sending representatives of our police department and our fire department, particularly those involved in our communications, to that meeting to make sure that we are informed and understand how we will be moving forward. I have full expectation that as a result of that, it will enable us to better understand what resources that we will need to be able to communicate through all of our agencies through one communication system. And that's what we've been trying to achieve through this study over the last 3 years. So we are finally, we do believe, at conclusion of that, and will very, very soon be bringing some additional information to our council of how we will, how we would implement that program for us. As you had noted earlier in your reports from all of our departments, there's a couple of things that I wanted to highlight for you, and one of those was to particularly note how we finished 2016 relative to housing starts. I had an opportunity to share some of this information at a chamber event this past Friday, but I think it's worth noting, and I think it's worth celebrating for us as well. The highest that we have ever had in housing starts was back in 2003. We had 435 housing starts during that period, and we actually at that time thought that we did not believe that we would ever be able to really handle much more than that. In 2016, we exceeded that number. We had 521 housing starts during 2016. 435 again was our high back in 2003. We were at 230 in 2014, 290 in 15, and then reaching 521. What is also significant as we watch the continued development in our own local community is that 2015 was a high for us when we looked at permit valuations citywide. $123,606,000 in 2015. That was our record high until 2016. We more than doubled that number at $284,839,502 at permit valuation for development within the boundaries of our municipality. That is not counting development around our community. That is simply that took place inside the city of Greer. That may have been my cue.
Nice tune.
That's right, nice tune. And the last thing that I needed to share with council tonight is that one of the things that we have been anxiously awaiting was some additional information from our partners at Greer CPW. As you are aware, we have been planning now for several years. We implemented about 3 years ago in our budgeting process, dedicating some resources to the Highway 29 corridor. One of those improvements for us was to completely convert our high-pressure sodium lighting on that street to LED lighting and also to include decorative lighting fixtures. We had been budgeting, believing that project was going to fall in at about $2.5 million. When we last met, we indicated that there was some concern that available resources for labor for the installation of that project, because that would not be self-performed, that would be put out to a contractor. There was some concern that bids would actually come in a little bit higher than that. We are very, very pleased that the materials and the labor for that project has been bid by Greer CPW, and that project has come in at $2,120,062. We obviously will have some additional work that we would want to do as a matter of that project, some gateway improvements there that we have discussed previously, also some landscape improvements to our medians there. And then, of course, we would need some contingency that's there. You will need to give us instruction as we move forward on how much we will fund that out of cash, how much of that we may do as a matter of bonding, and we've had conversation about that previously. We are in the process, Mr. Seifert and myself will be meeting with our financial advisors, with our bonding attorneys in the latter part of January. We will be bringing a proposal, we'll be evaluating what may be in the best interest of the city long-term relative to that project and other projects that we have on our drawing board moving forward. That's why our March meeting is so important. It's very strategic for us in council, giving us direction exactly on how some of those resources will be spent. But in the short term, it is necessary for us to allow CPW to enter into a contractual relationship to order those materials and to enter into a contract with the vendor for installation of that lighting project. Since this is a project that we have reviewed previously and it is in our work plans for 2017, it is my intent to issue a notice to proceed to Greer CPW, but obviously I did not want to issue a notice to proceed to them if there were any objections or concerns by council of us issuing that notice to proceed.
Council, any reservations in that regard? It's a great project, one that I think will help shape the future entrances of our city and provide some real identity along that stretch of road that is badly needed. So thank you for your affirmation in that regard.
Very good. We will proceed, and we'll issue notice to proceed to them. And then again, we will be coming back to council specific to whether or not we're using cash or bonding or some combination of that, because our arrangement with Greer CPW is they will manage the contract. The contracts are issued in their name. They will make all payments relative to the work, and then they will submit those on a monthly basis to us as the work is conducted on a remit basis. So we will make those payments to them as a refund against that project, but they will manage that project on our behalf and their behalf as we would continue to move forward. So wanted to make sure we were all on the same page and moving forward with that project. That concludes my remarks and information in for my administrator's report. I do ask council's consideration for a couple of additional items in executive session. Your agenda is already showing executive session for both a contractual matter and legal briefing concerning the sale of property relative to the Allen Bennett Memorial Hospital campus. But I'm also asking council's consideration tonight to allow me to have some information presented to you on two separate personnel matters. One of those involving our recreation department and one our police department, and then also a contractual matter that would involve the purchase of a piece of property, the potential purchase of a piece of property, and then also an economic development matter relative to an ongoing economic development project that we have been working with Greer Development Corporation. So in addition to the legal contractual matter concerning the Allen Bennett site, I'm also asking your consideration for two separate personnel, one contractual and one economic development in executive session.
Thank you, sir. I appreciate the information.
I'm going to say something before we move on. Mr. Driggers?
Yes, sir.
I wanted to thank you and staff today, Mr. Shell and Ms. Adams, for hosting Leadership Greer. I had the privilege of setting that session up for local government. And as you know, we hosted a mock city council meeting here this afternoon. You were talking about transparency, and that was part of the discussion. And I think it was very eye-opening for all of the members of this year's class of 37. They really got to see that there's plenty of healthy debate and a lot of issues that require a lot of thought and discussion. And we even had some antsy observers that wanted to chime in and give their two cents. And so they were real appreciative for all the hard work that you did, and we really appreciate you hosting us and having us today.
Thank you. Were glad to have that group in. It is always wonderful to participate with the Chamber on Local Government Day as part of that program. But I will say we had seven members of that class that sat in your seats earlier today, and some of them seemed to really like it.
They really did a good job, but thank you for making that possible.
We're glad to do that. Thank you.
Council will move to appointments of boards and commissions. We have this evening opening in a Board of Zoning Appeals in District 6. Mr. Dewey Tarwater, many of you know, who has served faithfully for a number of years, has resigned, and we need to fill that. Ms. Albert, I believe you have someone to nominate this evening.
Yes, I do. I have given everyone a copy of Mr. Henry's resume. You can see it's quite lengthy, into various different, from his education on to different positions held at different companies. He is retired at this time, but he is willing to take the position on the Board of Zoning Appeals, and it would be my privilege for him to do that.
We consider that a motion. Do I hear a second? Any further discussion or questions? Ms. Adams?
Yes.
Griffin?
Yes.
Ms. Booker?
Yes.
Mr. Dooley?
Yes.
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 Yes. Council, there is a vacancy created by expiration of term on our election commission. Ms. Alveda Williams has filled that position. Do we have any information in regards to her continued service or a nomination for the elections commission?
She's not going to be able to continue to serve, so you're going to have to find somebody for that position.
All right. We'll need somebody to serve on our election commission.
That is an at-large position, and there are three members of that commission, and of course their involvement would be during our next city election, so we would ask council's consideration for that position as an at-large, so all members of council have been able to consider that. We are glad to share. Ms. Duncan works very, very closely with that group, and we're glad to share any information with you concerning the other members and their involvement and the duties and responsibilities and time demands for that position. But we know that you take that very, very seriously, and we look forward to receiving a nomination for that as you continue to seek someone.
Thank you. And the last this evening is the Greer Development Corporation Board of Directors. As provided notice to you that Mr. Larry Wilson, who has served on that board for a number of years, has advised us that he would not seek reappointment to that board, and so it left an at-large opening. I have provided for you information on a candidate that I would like to nominate, and that would be Mr. Kevin Duncan. Mr. Duncan is a lifetime-long resident of the city of Greer. His dad and granddad owned Duncan Pontiac, and that was their family business for a number of years. Kevin is a 2002 graduate of the University of South Carolina and has been in the banking business since his graduation there. He serves on the Greer Chamber Executive Board, on the Greer Relief Board, Memorial United Methodist Church. He currently serves on our Board of Zoning Appeals and would need to step down from that position, but also works with the Greer State Bank Foundation. I'd like to nominate Kevin for that position and would welcome a second.
Second.
Have a motion and a second. I hear any further discussion regarding Kevin Duncan to serve an at-large board position for the Greer Development Corporation. Ms. Adams?
Yes.
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 Yes. Council, in our only item of old business this evening, I have asked that a request to recall ordinance number 34-2016 be placed on the agenda this evening. Let me clarify this request. As you are aware, at our last meeting, there was a considerable time spent both in our meeting as well in an executive session as we considered where we were in regards to ordinance number 34-2016. Having had much debate on that and needing some time to sort through some of the questions that had been raised and some of the issues that we needed to address, this table had placed a motion to table ordinance number 34-2016, and that is where it abides right now. I have asked that it be placed on our agenda for reconsideration by pulling it from the table and placing it on our January 24th, 2000 agenda. So there will be no action this evening beyond seeking a motion to recall the ordinance from the table and place it on a future agenda. With that, I'll open the floor for discussion or motion.
Make the motion to recall the ordinance, place it on the January 24th agenda.
Second.
I have a motion and a second. Any further discussion in that regard? Ms. Adams?
Yes.
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 Yes. Council will move to items of new business. The first and final reading of Resolution 1-2017, a resolution to accept O'Neill Village Subdivision Streets
namely Noble Street and Noldy Street, into the City of Greer Street System. Mr. Pace, floor is yours, sir.
Thank you, Mayor, Council. This would usually be a time for Mr. Grant to be here. However, he is on a trip back from Florida for some ball game. But if I could, I'd just like to let you know that January the 19th, again, another date for your calendar, is... our historic survey, resource survey, will be started in that week, January the 15th and 16th and 19th. We will hold a public community meeting here in City Hall from 4 o'clock to 6:30 p.m. And again, we'll be looking at approximately 850 properties throughout the city with this survey. This survey will aid us in providing information for further expansion of historic districts or national registered properties, and or creating new historic districts, which could be either local or national nominees for that. These surveys will be conducted by the firm that we approved as a few weeks ago, back in November, Brockington and Associates, to move forward with that survey. They will be out in the trenches doing those surveys. So we've provided them with information and IDs that when they're out and about in the community, you can let your constituents know that they'll have proper ID, but, you know, they're okay. Don't shoot, please. But really, they'd just be out there doing the survey for us, and we're excited about it and excited to move forward in that regards. Following up with the PowerPoint and presentation for Mr. Grant today on O'Neill Village Phase 2 street acceptance, this development was permitted in April of 2015. It did include asphalt, or it will include asphalt streets, and curbs have been constructed for this phase. Streets are 24 feet in width and a right-of-way of 44 feet. Sidewalks will be constructed as lots are developing inside that area now. City staff has monitored street construction and inspected all streets and curbs in this phase, and found it to be all in satisfactory condition. And therefore, staff is recommending accepting these Phase 2 streets into the city for ownership and maintenance. And he has included with this also a diagram of the subdivision. So if you have any questions, I will try to answer those. And if not, we'll get Steve when he gets back.
Council, on the recommendation of staff, do I hear a motion to receive Resolution 1-2017?
So moved. Second.
Have a motion and a second. Any further questions or discussion in that regard? Ms. Adams?
Yes.
Griffin?
Yes.
Ms. Book?
Yes.
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 Thank you, Mayor, Council.
Thank you. Second item before us this evening in new business is the first reading of Ordinance Number 1-2017. This is an ordinance amending the City of Greer Code of Ordinance Chapter 2, Administration, Article 5, Purchasing Rules and Procedures, Section 2293, Small Purchases, Section 2-294, Regular Purchases, Section 2-295, Emergency Purchases, Section 2-296, Central Storehouse, and Section 2297, Other General Rules. Action is required. Mr. Seifert.
Thank you, Mayor and Council. The staff across the city have reviewed our purchasing ordinance, and we have had some requests. We made some amendments, and we present these here to you tonight for your consideration. And trying to cover this is, I just want to cover the substantive changes and where those take place. So beginning in Section 2-293, covering small purchases, where the definition of the small purchases for practical purposes and daily uses is the purchases in the city that do not require a purchase order. Right now, that limit is currently under $500. So we've had requests from certain departments, especially in public services, that in the cases of vehicles breaking down, they need to go buy a part, repair the truck, get it back on the road. And a lot of times these parts are coming in at greater than $500, and to go through the purchase order process is delaying that purchase and delaying getting that truck back on the road. So for using that as an example, we have requested that you consider raising the minimum threshold for not requiring a purchase order from $500 to $1,000. We feel that is an adequate amount at this time to cover most of those purchases, covering the emergencies and small supplies and parts that allow us to react quickly and cover those needs without requiring the use of a purchase order. Other amendments throughout that whole section are just clarification of the text and title changes. Does not really change our processes. Moving to Section 2-294, regular purchases, the definition there of a regular purchase is a purchase that does require a purchase order. So that purchase is anything greater than $1,000, so it follows in line from the small purchases of the amendment that we're requesting there. Moving down to what is currently Step 5 will be changed to Step 4. Our limits before we are required by ordinance to go to a formal bid process is currently $5,000. And we are requesting that you consider changing that limit to $10,000. This is our formal bid limit. And this increase, it helps accommodate the increases in prices and streamline our processes, lowering the expenditure cost of that formal bid process. And then moving down to what is currently Step 7, which will be Step 5, the current limit of $25,000 is where the limit that the administrator has the authorization to approve purchases. We're requesting that we raise that limit to $35,000, giving a little more discrepancy in the authorization to the administrator to approve the purchases and projects up to $35,000. And then the next page is currently Step 8 will be Step 6. That marks the excess of any project or purchase in excess of $35,000 will still come to council for that final approval. All other changes throughout the amendments that we're presenting here are, again, clarification of text, eliminating some procedures, streamlining those procedures, and clarifying some title changes and department name changes. We do request this for your consideration and approval.
Council, on the recommendation of staff, I'll entertain a motion to receive first reading of ordinance number 1-2017.
So moved.
Have a motion and now have a second. Further discussion? Questions of Mr. Seifert?
Just for curiosity, under, I guess it's on page 4 of 8, under emergency purchases, step one is that the department head has to verbally explain the emergency situation to the administrator or the mayor in the absence of the city administrator. What do we do if the administrator and the mayor are not available?
As a matter of practice, and they can be the mayor pro tem. If that's not available, we can go to the assistant administrator. And if it's truly an emergency, it may be a time that it'll either have to wait or we'll have to ask for forgiveness. That's our options. But if it's an emergency purchase and it affects delivery of services, depending on the scope of how big the cost is, we would either have to hold it, or if it's close, and we would probably go ahead and do it in an emergency situation.
Driggers, what's a typical example, especially in the new limit of 10 to 35, that you would approve a purchase of?
Well, from 25 to 35. Or what would fall in that range of 10 to 35?
Yeah.
It would be an item that we've placed to bid that, a bid of that amount. It could be a construction project. It could be a small construction project. It could be the purchase of electronic equipment. It could be anything that would be in the general, just the general nature of day-to-day business. But it's just a matter of...
So it includes a project also?
It could include a project. But remember, I can't place a project out to bid that hasn't been approved by council. So, I mean, we would not even be bidding it if it isn't a project that has been previously approved by council. It's just the matter of at that limit. Now, you may recall that there's a number of times, even at the $25,000 limit, we will bring projects to council below that limit, and that's typically because something unusual. One bidder, for example. Anytime we only have one bidder, we believe that it's been a good practice to bring that to council and say, look, we only had the one. Or if there are some extenuating circumstances, like that we're not recommending the low bidder. So if it's not the low bidder, instead of me approving that, I would bring that to council to say, we're recommending that we go with the second bidder for these reasons, but it's below the statutory limit that I could have approved. But I typically would bring those anyway. These are more of those routine purchases. We're just getting to the point that $25,000 isn't what $25,000 used to be, but we're trying to keep those increments in line with the shifts that we made in the other amounts. You know, so if we went to 5 to 10, we're not looking to go from 25 to 50. We're not just saying that they're being doubled. We're trying to keep those in line with those amounts. I will say, I have absolutely no reservation whatsoever if it's council's desire that we would keep those levels where they are relative to approval of bids. I am perfectly comfortable with that. I have no issue with that whatsoever. Where this originated were particularly those purchases on the lower end, that 500 to 1,000 range, that 1,000 to 5,000 ranges. It's just gotten to the point that it was becoming truly burdensome to make those smaller purchases by having to go out and get multiple pricing.
Others? Ms. Adams?
Yes.
Yes.
Booker? Yes.
Mr. Davis?
Yes.
No.
Yes.
Mayor Danner.
Yes. Council, in executive session, we have a number of items to discuss this evening for consideration, for your consideration. We've got one legal and one contractual matter that pertain to the sale of Allen Bennett property located at Wade Hampton Boulevard Memorial Drive to receive legal advice concerning a potential lawsuit involving the sale of the Allen Bennett property. In addition to those two items, we have two personnel matters, one other contractual matter, and one economic development matter. I'll entertain a motion to go into executive session for consideration of those six items.
Motion.
I have a motion. Do I hear a second? I have a second. Ms. Adams?
Airwood.
Yes.
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 Yes. Yes. Executive session this evening, we have considered a contractual and a legal matter pertaining to the sale of Allen Bennett Hospital located at the corner of Wade Hampton Boulevard Memorial Drive. We've also received legal advice concerning a potential lawsuit involving the sale of the property. We've taken no action in that regard. While in executive session, we considered two personnel matters, one other contractual matter, and one economic development matter.
under consideration. We've taken no action in regards to any of those other matters. Having taken no action in executive session, I'll entertain a motion that we adjourn from executive session.
So moved.
Second.
Motion and a second. Ms. Adams?
Mr. Airwood?
Yes.
Yes.
Booker?
Yes.
Mr. Dumas?
Yes.
Yes.
Albert?
Yes.
Mayor Danner?
Yes. Council, stand adjourned.